everyone, welcome. Today is Tuesday, September the 16th, 2014. This is Paul Sandhu coming to you with another episode of Wake Up and Live Radio. I have on the line with me today a repeat guest who has been with us some many times now, and that is Ms. Leuren Moret from Berkeley, California. Leuren is an independent scientist she is a journalist. She has traveled the world. She has appeared on many tribunals and panels and committees to debate and discuss and to inform people of the dangers of radiation, of depleted uranium, of the nuclear industry, and much more. So without further ado, hello and welcome, Leuren.
Hello, Paul. Nice to be on your show again, and I always enjoy being interviewed by you. It's always wonderful. Thank you.
Well, you know, the feeling is mutual because you are a wonderful guest, because you have, you have studied your information and your research is very detailed, and that is always I learn much, when we do these programs myself, as do the listeners. So, what has been in the forefront of your radar in the past, little while since we last spoke, maybe 6 weeks ago or so? What has been going on in the world that has caught your attention?
Well, I think that the downing of the two Malaysian planes, MH370 in March, and then MH17 over the Ukraine in August, or was it July? July, has really alerted me to this pivot to Asia that Obama's been talking about and will be his legacy. But it has a very dark history, and it's very menacing to civil society, because it will not only affect the Ukraine, but it's an indication that the Western powers will be using NATO to take over countries and loot them and rape them and destroy the environment and then leave and move on to the next country. And just as we are speaking today, in September of 2014, and we're going to discuss the Ukraine for part of this interview, the Obama announced yesterday on September 15th that he's sending troops to two countries in Africa because of the Ebola breakout. And Britain has been asked by, I believe it was Nigeria, to send their troops for problems they're having. So here we have these military excursions that are really based on requests by the host country, or a country that is troubled for some reason. And in the case of Africa, it's the Ebola breakout. In the case of the Ukraine, it's part of the eastern part of the Ukraine where people are pro-Russian, and they're actually primarily ethnic Russians who want to secede from the Ukraine and become part of Russia, as the Crimea did in the spring. I believe it was in April. They had a referendum and voted to leave the Ukraine and to become part of the country of Russia, the state of Russia. So that brought in NATO, it brought in the United States, who is interested in looting the country, getting the oil and gas rights, fracking the country. And right now, this week, in two more days, Scotland will be voting on seceding from England, from Great Britain, over the fracking issue. And that also has become an issue in the eastern Ukraine, where Chevron, British Petroleum, and I believe ExxonMobil all have interests in fracking and drilling for oil and gas. And of course, that destroys the local water supplies, poisons them, just as they've done in the U.S., in Australia, in New Zealand. In fact, they've done fracking all over the world for the last 8 or 10 years. And they're using chemicals that are actually completely illegal, but they get a waiver because it's often Halliburton doing the fracking, and that is basically the Rothschilds.
So, Lorenz, sorry to interrupt you, but I think you have covered a lot of territory in your brief introduction here. So, you know, we would perhaps focus on one of the topics at a time. Mm-hmm. So, now you mentioned things like pivot to Asia, and of course, you know, Ebola in Africa, these fracking issue and other problems in Ukraine, the adventures and misadventures of NATO and their dark agenda. So, you know, we are, let's begin perhaps by going to, since that is that topic predates this Ebola issue, let's talk about Ukraine and the spirit to Asia.
Yes,
what's going on in Ukraine, and you know, what information have you received in regards to this matter?
Well, this all started with the colored revolutions of George Soros that were actually mostly student movements that started it starts in universities where foreign students are invited to universities, for instance, Berkeley, UC Berkeley here in California. And I've had roommates who were part of the Open Society program. They bring them from Mongolia, Kazakhstan, countries that are targeted for their oil and mineral resources by the New World Order, and George Soros is their agent. This is also going to happen in the countries with the Ebola outbreaks. Soros is already busy and involved in those countries. And the students are taught how to overthrow their own countries. And it's even happening in the United States as a result of the Occupy movement, which is a George Soros-funded open society project within the United States. And so the Orange Revolution is the revolution that began in the Ukraine. And a woman named Tymoshenko, she's a sort of a blonde woman with a Russian braid that she wears on her head. And
that's their ex-prime minister, isn't it?
Yes, she was an appointed prime minister for a short period of time. And she immediately illegally transferred funds out of the country that go to the IMF or the World Bank or the Federal Reserve. She's part of a series of very crooked, very corrupt ministers and politicians who have infiltrated the Ukrainian government for the purpose, under the guidance and the orders of the U.S. State Department and Victoria Nuland. They are looting the money, the resources, giving contracts to oil companies at very cheap prices. And they've also started a movement to have the Ukraine join the EU. And the present president, Poroshenko, who's an oligarch who supposedly made billions of dollars in the last 20 years selling chocolate in the Ukraine, but actually he's a drug and arms dealer. So he's another one of these shady characters and there seem to be a lot of them in Eastern Europe. They are also being used to disrupt and overthrow governments so that the US and NATO can get into Eastern European countries to surround Russia and to put ballistic missiles under US supervision into their countries, pointed straight at Moscow. And this is getting to be a template. It's getting to be a regular thing with Eastern European countries, and they've tried to do it with the Central Asian former oil-rich republics that were part of the Soviet Union as well.
So yes, so then it seems then Ukraine is it would be the doorway for NATO and the West into Russia, and it would be sort of a containment strategy to contain Russia. Why does Russia pose a threat to them? Because Russia, I thought, had come out of the communist system and had become a capitalist country, and they were all buddy buddies for a while. So where did this rift come from?
Well, the rift came from basically the hidden power that is behind all the land grabs, the resource grabs, and the using NATO and also private contractors
Blackwater?
Yes, Blackwater. Blackwater has been involved in the Ukraine overthrow of the last, I've forgotten his name,
Yurishenko or something.
Yeah, Yurishenko. His overthrow, and there were some demonstrations called the Maidan demonstrations in the big public square in Kiev. One was in December, and then I believe another one was in March of 2014, December 2013 and March of 2014. And 40 of the Blackwater contractors were shot dead by snipers in the Maidan demonstration in March. That's a lot of contractors. And apparently there were, people don't really know who it was, but there were people, snipers there, who were shooting both sides of the Maidan demonstration and also the U.S. contractors in the square with the demonstrators.
Okay. Yeah, this story is right from the beginning, it's been very suspicious as to, you know, who was involved. Yes. And who's doing what, because certainly what's been reported in the Western media, we cannot believe any of it, that this is, because this certainly seems to me was not started by Putin, was it?
Oh, no, he's been very, very open and declared many times that Russia will not be involved in any wars over the Ukraine. He's not interested in wars. He can only lose money, lose support of the Russian people by involving Russia in wars. And what he is bound to do by the Constitution of Russia, which is exactly what he's fulfilling, his legal obligation as leader of the country, is to protect Russian populations from mistreatment or whatever in other countries. Now, the Ukraine is an independent country. It gained its independence from the Soviet Union 22 years ago when the Soviet Union was dismantled it collapsed basically because of the Chernobyl disaster, which was a false flag. And the United States was very involved in it. I was working at the Lawrence Berkeley lab, and I know that when Chernobyl happened, and I know that Livermore lab people, scientists and Department of Energy people and so forth were in the Soviet Union at the time that Chernobyl happened, and they were behind the fence at Chernobyl right after it happened, and Gorbachev was the targeted with a coup. It was pretty chaotic over there. But an Indian admiral, Admiral Bhagwat, Vishnu Bhagwat, told me that he had been to the Soviet Union many times inspecting their nuclear power plants. He'd been to Chernobyl, and he said there's no way that was an accident, that there were 12 levels of safety measures that had to be dismantled in a specific order in order for Chernobyl to have happened. And he said it was deliberately done to take down the Soviet Union and end the Cold War. So you see these transformations of power and geopolitics and politics. Politicians and governments are triggered by these false flag events, and almost all of them involve nuclear materials. I discovered that when I was looking at global oil prices since 1946, and I said each time the value of the dollar declines, the oil prices decline. And what they do is they have a false flag, Chernobyl, 9/11, Mogadishu, Somalia, a Gaza attack, Iraq attack. All these wars and false flags are happening to boost the value of the dollar and therefore oil prices, because oil prices were pegged to the value of the dollar. So it's all manipulated, Paul. It's amazing to discover this stuff, but it's all on the front page. None of this is classified. You just have to think of ways to tease the information out over specific events and then put those events together, pegged to, in my case, to the dollar value in oil prices. And then there it's just as plain as day. It's very easy to understand. And so the Ukraine is no different than what's happened in Iraq, Afghanistan. There's an excuse for Western powers, NATO, the U.S., to move in with the military and military advisors and other kinds of advisors. The oil companies come with them, because that's actually who the beneficiaries are. And also with them come the fantastically wealthy oligarchs who, in the case of the Ukraine, they are not only funding snipers and Halliburton and Blackwater, but other private contractors, Polish ones, and from other countries, and they come in and they're lawless. They shoot anyone they want to. There's no reparations for them. They're outside of the law, and they are not accountable. And that's exactly what's happening in the Ukraine. But what happened in Maidan, the demonstrations that should have been peaceful, is that snipers came, and it turns out that they had been hired by the oligarchs. Komonoisky is one of the major ones, and he's the governor of one of the eastern provinces involved in secession from the Ukraine, they're pro-Russian people. And something like 85 or 90% of the oil and gas deposits in the Ukraine, and there are a lot of them, are in that eastern part that is trying to secede. So he's living in Switzerland because he doesn't want to get arrested for war crimes that he's already committed in other countries. And he has hired mercenaries who not only were in the demonstrations in Maidan in Kiev that overthrew the democratically elected government, But they are now also funding private contractors who are embedded in the Ukrainian military presence there, the government troops and the government National Guard, that are trying to fight the militia, the volunteer militia in the eastern part of the Ukraine, and they are fighting for independence from the Ukraine. The oil companies, of course, and the oligarchs don't want to lose the treasures they are looting from, especially that part of the Ukraine, but also after the last president had to flee to Russia for his life, the U.S. government, in other words, Victoria Nuland in the State Department, appointed a new temporary government in the Ukraine. That's not even legal. It's an illegal government. And they were sworn in on February 27th, just before the demonstrations in March in the Maidan demonstration in Kiev. And a new prime minister was appointed. They had to have an election for the president. And so this new temporary prime minister, who is a banker himself and a real sleaze, his name is Yatsenyuk, and I couldn't even believe this, he transferred and flew to Washington, D.C. on March the 6th. All of the gold reserves that belonged to the Ukrainian people, the Ukrainian government, and they were secreted to a plane that was waiting on the runway in the middle of the night outside of Kiev, and 33 tons of gold were moved by American special ops, either government special ops or hired special ops spies such as Blackwater, and the gold bars were packed in 40 boxes. They were put on a plane without any markings on it, and it took off. It had the engine running the whole time, and it got the heck out of the Ukraine as fast as the gold was loaded, and a mysterious person appeared at the last minute and got on the plane, boarded the plane, and I have photographs of Obama on March the 7th with Yatsenyuk, the former prime minister of the Ukraine, but at that time he was acting prime minister and appointed, I'm sorry, he was prime minister and appointed, he was temporarily appointed prime minister, as well as being he was appointed the president, I'm sorry, temporarily. So he was prime minister and president, and he was in Obama's office in the White House doing this shaking hands stuff and buddy buddy with Obama, and of course he got something like a 10% cut for delivering those gold bars to New York City to the Federal Reserve. They were deposited in the basement of JP Morgan. So this is how they do it.
So what you're saying is then this is the MO is that wherever this destabilization occurs, there's always intent of looting, whatever treasures or gold or anything that is of value. So now with this tug of war that's going on between Russia and the West over Ukraine, what do you foresee the outcome to be? Like, could this lead to some kind of war, or how is this going to end?
Well, this is one of the most important overthrows that have happened, and this will affect everything, at least for the next 10 years, in terms of the policies that Russia follow through on and why they are defending their borders This is encroachment and this is harassment of Russia. They have done nothing illegal and they are constitutionally bound to protect ethnic Russians who are being genocided in eastern Ukraine in order for the oligarchs and the oil companies to loot the company of its natural resources. And Tymoshenko said publicly within the last 6 months, and it ended up in the media, that this was over the Crimea. And they had a referendum and voted to, legally voted to join Russia and leave the state of Ukraine. That successfully happened. Eastern Ukrainians are being genocided, and Tymoshenko, who was the former prime minister, she stated in a phone conversation that was leaked that that they should get nuclear weapons, the Ukrainian government, and go into the Crimea and wipe out the Russians there and their leader, meaning Putin, and that they should destroy the entire Russian population, pro-Russian population, in the Ukraine with nuclear weapons. And that's a horrific statement because that's exactly what they're doing. It's and now they've been using.
So now, as you, I've read recently that after that NATO summit, that they are now arming the Ukrainian, the anti-Russian side. That NATO is arming them. The West is supplying them, France and England and U.S. They're all supplying them arms so they can exacerbate this conflict and make it bigger. Is that what you also see happening there?
Well, what has happened is that the president Poroshenko sent troops in there. That the war this conflict actually started, armed conflict, in March, and at that time the Eastern Ukrainians, the pro-Russian ones, realized that they were going to be genocided, and they did not want to be under this illegal government. That's a pretty reasonable reason to secede. So they had very valid grounds and legal grounds, and Russia's been on legal grounds in helping them, assisting them. But Putin knew that this was really the U.S. and the British and the oil companies trying to lure Russia, pull them into a world war. And that would drain money from the economy of Russia. It would block and stop and modify the growth effects. Russia is going through a huge transformation right now, and they are also allying with China. And so that would have been, this conflict was a way to draw Russia into a big world war, which NATO and the Western countries want because their economies are all collapsing. And they make money on wars. So,
Poroshenko. So the agenda is to instigate a war.
Yes.
To cover up their decline of their own economies.
Yes.
And a decline of their economic power.
Right.
So that a war would hide those the criminal activities that the major banks have been involved in, and secondly, it would offer perhaps more control to the elites, because at the end of the day, when it's all said and done and everything has been destroyed, then they can rebuild from the pieces, order out of chaos. Is that
yes, what they do is they create chaos, and then the oil companies and other entities, interests that want to loot the natural resources, come in when the country's destroyed, or even during the conflict. Already oil companies were fracking. while the soldiers were fighting. And finally, the oil companies left because the war got so dangerous. And no one ever expected the militia, the volunteer militia, the pro-Russia troops. These are just ordinary people who are picking up Kalashnikovs, and that's all they had, a few guns to start with. Well, Russia helped them. Putin had advisors who went in and advised them. And then there were some Russian soldiers who volunteered on their holidays and went in. That is legal for them to volunteer, because the Ukraine has volunteers also. And then the conflict flared up because the poor Ukrainian soldiers who were conscripted were not trained. Some of them weren't even given guns, and they were sent to this war front. They had a lot of equipment. They had about 25 Su-25s. Those are small fighter jets that were manufactured and designed during the Soviet era. And many of the third world countries still have them. The Ukrainian troops were well outfitted, but they were not well trained. The militia had no equipment at all, just some old Kalashnikovs, rifles, but they seemed to be well trained. They seemed to be spiritually inspired, and they were doing this conflict. They were going to war for the right reasons. It was to save the lives of their people, because they are being targeted for genocide. And but the Russian troops did not want to fight. They did not want to go to war against the pro-Russian Ukrainians, because they call them their brothers. They're all the same people. So this became an issue. And what happened is the militia started capturing and surrounding. They had like 7,500 Ukrainian government troops surrounded and forced them to surrender. And they had to leave all their equipment, all their tanks and guns and their Buk missile launchers and their grads, and in order to get out of this the prison camp they were in. So they were released, and the militia gained all of the anti-personnel carriers, the tanks, everything. So they began using those. Now, they're much better strategically than the Ukrainian government troops. So they ended up surrounding them again, another 7,500 Ukrainian government soldiers ended up surrounded. And their equipment was taken away. But in that military pincer movement, it was actually the Stalingrad pincer movement that Khrushchev carried out to keep the Germans out of Russia in World War II, the very same movement surrounded these Ukrainian government troops. And they were also released. They had to leave their equipment as well. And they were shooting down, the militia were shooting down all the planes, finally, that the Ukrainian troops had. So the president of the Ukraine asked NATO countries to send more Su-25s and pilots without the Eastern troops knowing about it, or without the Eastern militia knowing about it. And almost all of the targeting with missiles, with mortars, with bombs, has been on the civilian population. The militia at first were fighting like rebels would fight, and they were doing insurgency in the cities. And so the Ukrainian troops just pounded the civilian sector and destroyed the cities, the houses, the homes. Many civilians have died, but maybe
so these are war crimes.
These are war crimes, and maybe 2,000 or 3,000 civilians have been killed. But the militia troops have killed at least 14,000 Ukrainian government troops, and
really?
Yes, they have taken all their equipment, and they have a better army, and they're better soldiers strategically than anything the Ukrainian government ever had. So
for this war, this civil war to continue, or to be to be more evenly matched, do you think that NATO will send in ground troops?
Well, what's happening now is Poroshenko bought Soviet-era tanks from Hungary, from their arsenal, and the Hungarian army needed money. They were broke. So they sold these old Soviet-era tanks, they're 50 years old, for $8,500 each, just basically scrap metal. And photos were taken of those tanks on trains headed for the Ukraine. And so then when the second 7,500 Ukrainian troops were surrounded just a month ago, it turns out in these war prisoners that there were 200 U.S. military advisors and trainers who were captured. Some of them were killed, and they had been training the Ukrainian government troops in anti-terrorism operations.
So what happened to these guys that were captured?
Well, they were released finally. Putin said release them. So the militia released them and, of course, kept all their equipment. But then what happened is this is twice that the commanders of the Ukrainian government troops were killed, wiped out in both of those big battles.
Now, I also read that a lot of these guys that were defecting over to Russia.
And so what happened is after the first group were surrounded, Poroshenko has provided almost no food since the conflict started. And they keep running out of supplies. They are walking out of a lot of situations because they don't have gasoline. They've run out of missiles, out of bullets. They don't even have arms. And so they surrender. They're fed up with no support from the Ukrainian government, from the Kiev. They call them the Nazis. And so they've walked across the border, 600 at a time, into Russia and joined the Russian army. So they're being trained and for probably 4 months, and then they're being sent back in to work with the militia.
Okay, that's good. So let's move on from this. Yeah. So this is something that you that looks like it's going to drag on for a while. I don't see any.
Putin is not going to invade the Ukraine under any circumstances.
So they're going to allow Ukraine to self-destruct, basically.
Well,
he has to self-destruct.
Yes. All he has to do is to support the rebel movement. And Poroshenko and his government eventually is going to collapse, or there will be a coup.
I hear that they are already ready to flee to Switzerland, and it could happen relatively quickly.
That would be good. He does have elections planned for October, where the parliament seats, he has stated publicly, he wants to get rid of the troublemakers in the parliament who don't agree with him and what the Nazis want to do. So they're having another election in October, but he may have to flee before that election because it's very unstable. And already the
rebels could actually outrun the army and take Kiev.
Well, the security arm of the government is already wiretapping its own soldiers fighting in the eastern part of the Ukraine because they're afraid of retaliation from their own army turning on them and coming back to Kiev and assassinating them and taking the military. The military already in March in March the Navy went off with a flagship and the Ukrainian Navy ships and went to Sevastopol and joined the Russian Navy. The whole Navy evacuated the Ukraine in March. And the Novorossiya militia, that's the pro-Russian militia, they're getting the army troops from the government troops are joining them. And now other provinces or other sectors, areas of the Ukraine are demonstrating against Poroshenko and the Ukrainian government in Kiev because they don't want their sons conscripted for these wars, for this war, because there's no way to win it now for Poroshenko.
What it seems like to me, then, Lauren, is that this war is, which was not, the Ukrainian people themselves that wanted this to begin with, but they were sort of forced into it. Now, it is not going to be won by the Soros crowd, by the looks of it. So it seems like NATO is not going to be able to establish themselves in Ukraine, that Russia will maintain that sector, which is in their very strategic interest to do so. So is that the reason why that this limelight has now shifted from Ukraine to this ISIS and ISIL and all that sort of thing, because the powers that be realize that they're not going to have a victory there?
Oh, Obama has egg all over his face, all over his feet, all over his presidential suit. This is a total failure. And on top of that, it's bankrupting the United States. It's bankrupting the EU because now they have to pour money into Ukraine. Their militaries have to donate equipment, heavy equipment, tanks and planes and everything to the president of the Ukraine so he can go on. And it's the oligarchs and the oil companies that are going to profit. And basically the Ukrainian government and Poroshenko's actions have genocided his own Ukrainian army, which was part of the plan, genocided the pro-Russian people because the whole area is torn apart. All the houses and buildings are destroyed. The infrastructure's been blown up, the railroads and bridges and everything. And the whole entire eastern Ukraine where they've been fighting is now contaminated with depleted uranium. So now he's going to bring in, this was always planned this way, to bring in the mercenaries, and they are much more lethal. But Putin has trained and retrained the militia, so each time Poroshenko and the West, NATO and the US make a move, Putin retrains the militia and prepares them to be tougher. And so every time Poroshenko punches the eastern Ukraine, which he's really punching Putin, Putin punches back harder. And so this is not going to end this winter. This conflict is going to go on, and the militia will only get better. A lot of the militia are Cossacks. The Cossacks are the ancient warriors on horseback that came from Central Asia, from the Kazakh tribes and the Khazar tribes, or Khazars. And they're very, very tough people to begin with. And there are a lot of women, young women, who volunteered. and you can see they're spiritually dedicated to protecting the people, the civilians, and their land. And they're entitled to do that. That's a perfectly reasonable and sane reason for going to war. They don't want to go to war. They have been forced to survive.
So this is again another one of those insane adventures, tragedies, because I mean, a lot of people, you know, their lives are destroyed, they get killed, their countries are destroyed, and that seems to be a repeat of everything that has gone on in the 20th century, and it just doesn't seem to come to an end.
These are called templates. The nuclear weapons program was a template. And it one man went, Hansgerg, was a scientist, an engineer from Vienna. He went to Japan, the U.S., England, Germany, Russia, and he gave them the same nuclear weapons program before the war and during the war. One man did, and I traced who was sponsoring him. It was an industrialist in Pittsburgh, an American, recruited him in Vienna, set up a magnesium plant in Austria, and magnesium is used to make the uranium for the bombs. And I looked up his name, Bauer, and I discovered that actually his last name is Winter. His middle name was Bauer. That was his part of his parents' last name. And the Bauers are the name of the Rothschilds before they changed their name to Rothschild in Germany, in Frankfurt.
That's
B-A-U-E-R,
I guess.
B-A-U-E-R. So the whole nuclear weapons program that started in World War II was Rothschild. And this is a template going in, invading these countries with an excuse. There's a plague, or there's an ethnic conflict, or there's a genocide going on. There's some excuse to go in. And then it turns into just raping the country, scouring the country of anything of any value, transferring all the money out, and then walking away after they've destroyed the entire environment.
I know, like wherever they go, there seems to be a lot of bloodshed. So it is.
Yes.
It is then not a stretch to claim that these are very satanic people, and
yes.
And they're whatever secondary reasons like money and resources may be, but it seems like to me that the primary reason is just to kill and to destroy.
Yes.
Which is, of course, the calling card of Satan. All right, so...
And that is, and above everyone else, the oligarchs, the oil companies, everything, the controlling entity for all the world wars, everything, for the last, since the 1500s, it's actually the Jesuits. And if you do a Google search on Jesuit institutions globally, the country with more Jesuit institutions than any other country in the world, Paul, is India. And that's why India has had such great difficulty. And it was a Portuguese explorer, Vasco da Gama, who took the Jesuits to Goa, on the west coast of India, and that's where the trouble started, and that spread to China, the opium wars. The Jesuits run the global drug racket. They run, they own all the oil companies, the Seven Sisters, and they control BP, although it belongs to Queen Elizabeth.
Yes, you know, that of course is the pyramidal structure of power in this world, and you're right that the Jesuits are right at the top there and very well kept secret. It was not that big a secret in the 19th and and or even among the European and Latin American people, is better known than it is in the Americas. But in America, in the United States, it's certainly a very well kept secret. Yes, that's a good book. I read that. That's Edward.
Paris.
Paris. Edward, yes. Yes. I read The Secret History. Yeah, he's a good.
And so, this is what happened to Europe. Something like 90 countries finally threw the Jesuits out. And Switzerland even made laws that they can never come into Europe. What is good for Russia is that the Eastern Orthodox religion hates the Jesuits and will not allow them in Russia. If the Jesuits go into Russia, the Russia is finished. This is The Secret Terrorist by Bill Hughes, and this is the plan, the history of the Jesuits in the United States. And from our first day of independence, July 4, 1776, the Jesuits have plotted and planned to destroy the United States. They hate Christians, they hate Protestants, they hate the Constitution, they're slavers, and they're completely obsessed. They're completely insane. And I've said over and over again, the entity running what's going on now is insane. And it's the Jesuits. They're out of control.
Yes, I cannot argue that point. Now, what is going on? Shifting to the other continent, where it also has been in the news lately, is with this alleged, and I say that word alleged because what information that comes out of the mainstream media is so contradictory and so confusing that it's hard to evaluate what the reality is. But I'm talking about this Ebola outbreak that has been much in the news lately. And just today, I did a little short program for my channel on this, that the U.S. government is buying, the State Department is buying like 160,000 hazmat suits, and the government is telling all the hospitals and all the medical facilities to prepare for Ebola in the U.S. There was some professor out of one of the Ivy League schools saying, within by the end of September or October, it will be in the UK. There's a 16% or 20% chance it's going to be in the US by October. So, what's going on with this?
This is another scam like the bird flu and pathogens. I mean, my God, planes, military planes, commercial jets, passenger planes are flying over countries all over the world, spraying chemtrails to deliberately poison the populations. So if Ebola is there, it's not because it was there before. It's because it was manufactured, weaponized, and introduced through vaccines, or it's a false flag. It's being used as an excuse for England, the Anglo-American Permanent War Crimes Racketeering Syndicate, to start invading African countries and looting them of their resources. This is geopolitics in Africa. It involves all of Africa. It will go on until every mine, every scrap of mineral resources, every drop of oil, every rare metal, every rare earth, every mineral deposit in all of Africa has been looted. And in order to do that, they have to get rid of the people. And so they have to depopulate. How do they do that? Well, Warren Buffett and Bill Gates established a foundation. And Bill Gates and his wife, Melinda Gates, have been busy in Africa making sure that every African is vaccinated. Now,
I read somewhere that whenever these UN or whoever these vaccinators were, that now people in Africa finally wised up and they were stoning them, and they were just dispatching them out of their areas wherever they were trying to enforce these vaccination programs. Have you heard that?
Oh, absolutely. And an air marshal flying on a plane as an air marshal was attacked in the plane by an African with a syringe. And with that vaccine that they've been vaccinating Africans with, and he stabbed the air marshal with it. So that's proof right there that they know these are lethal vaccinations and that they're for the purpose of genocide. Now, a UN worker asked me to come and do some presentations on depleted uranium and radiation at the UC Berkeley extension program that they have. And he gave me a UN bulletin that the employees receive because it was about AIDS. He said, oh, I thought you'd be interested in this. Well, Paul, I took it home and I opened the AIDS article, and there was a little table with different countries in Africa listed and what percentage of their armies were infected with AIDS or HIV. And I looked at it. Some of them were 95% of the army was contaminated. And others, it was only 15 or 20%. It ranged over, you know, a large different amounts. And I said, gee, why would it be so uneven? And then I started thinking, what minerals are in each country? And the countries with the most minerals we want have the highest percentage of the army infected with AIDS.
And that comes, of course, from their vaccination programs that
yes.
have been done.
Yes.
Okay, so this alleged Ebola outbreak, in your opinion, then, or some of the evidence that I have read, would seem to indicate that it is nowhere near the extent that is being reported by the UN, by the WHO, and by the various media in the West, that
yes.
it may not even have been much of an outbreak, if at all. But of course, it can be blown up much bigger once the Western aid arrives. You know, then the real danger exists that this could actually become a much bigger epidemic or pandemic. What do you think?
Well, what's happened is that 67 or 70% of the supposed Ebola cases have not had any lab tests identifying the virus. And because of so many questionable things about it and no regulation or legal analyses being done on each of these reported cases, England has just passed a law that nothing can be reported in the media unless there is a lab test confirming that it's Ebola.
So when they tell us, oh, there are 20,000 that are infected, you know, that's just like a number that they pull out of a hat, then it seems.
Yes.
Like,
and
there's really no data to support
no.
that.
And we know the Western media will report anything their masters task them with. And there's absolutely no credibility left in the mainstream media in the West at all. And the way I've gotten the information that I have, which has not been reported in the media, for instance, the 14,000 Ukrainian soldiers who've died, government soldiers, is from a blog that the militia keep, and they post every single day. It's called The Voice of Sevastopol, and the soldiers, the city council members, and the towns being attacked, individuals can post events during the day, and then they're posted by midnight California time with video clips. So you can see the shelling of the Donetsk airport. You can see the dead soldiers. In fact, the government troops were doing a breakout through militia lines. They were trapped and encircled, And they filmed it on video. So this guy sitting on top of a tank was videotaping his whole battalion trying to escape. It's really exciting, and it was so good the militia put it on their website 2 days in a row. So these are the places I've been getting information, and the militia cannot, the pro-Russian people cannot get their story out into the mainstream media, and Poroshenko and the government agencies and officials are lying to their people. So everybody's reading the militia website now to find out what's really going on, and I can guarantee that NATO's reading it too.
Of course. So now this coming back to this Ebola topic.
Yes.
Lately, like in the last few days in particular, this story is being hyped that, you know, get ready, be prepared, it's coming to the U.S., it's going to spread. You know, do you see this professor with these charts and graphs? Okay, there's a 27% chance it'll be in the UK, it'll be in the US by such and such a date. So many people are going to die and blah, blah, blah. Do you think there is a plan to actually introduce this into the Western populations?
I'm not even sure if there's really an Ebola danger, because I've read from other doctors and experts on vaccines that Ebola can be cured with vitamin C. So I think it's a big, I think it's a false flag. I think it's another baloney scare tactic to make people frightened and accept more police state. Go for more vaccines, allow more vaccinations. We don't know what's in the vaccination.
But you see, what I have noticed, Lorraine, is that in Sierra Leone, for example,
yes,
they have a plan to quarantine the whole country.
Yes.
So what this is setting, like you talked about templates, so what this seems like it's setting the stage for is at some time in the future that is declared maybe as a result of this outbreak or a future outbreak, that, okay, there's this, you know, this fever XYZ that's broken out in New York City. Now we have to quarantine the whole city.
And that's what?
Because they're going to be forced vaccinations. And
yes.
So medical emergency laws,
yes,
are, from what I have read, are the most draconian.
Yes.
And it allows the government almost unlimited control over any area of the country or even the countries, as in this case.
It's an excuse to pass legislation or to take measures that take our liberty and freedom and constitutional rights away and replace it with a police state. We have Homeland Security in the United States now, and FEMA, they go hand in hand. They were developed secretly in Vietnam during the Vietnam War. It was called, the Homeland Security was the Phoenix program in Vietnam, and Project Popeye was the first weather modification experimentation that was done in undercover of the Vietnam War. And so what we are now under is Homeland Security and FEMA, and they are doing a rollout right now in Berkeley in California. We're watching it happen. We're right in the boiling pot right now. And it is, we call Homeland Security, they are the Jesuit fascists. They are the Jesuit Gestapo. That's exactly what they are. We're getting something even worse than communism in the Soviet Union. And I was told that in 1989 at the Lawrence Livermore Nuclear Weapons Lab when I was a staff scientist there, and there were two Soviet KGB generals who came to the Livermore lab, and my lab partner mentioned them, and I said, what are they doing here? This is the Cold War. This is one of the most protected facilities in the world. Why is our enemy here? And my lab partner said, they're transferring the technologies of political control to the United States government. I said, what for? And he said, well, they're turning the U.S. into the Soviet Union and the Soviet Union into the U.S. So this transformation that's going on right now, where Russia is rising with China, it's a new world economy that's being pumped by the Jesuits. And at the same time, they have to collapse the Western economy. So they're using the Ukrainian situation to further bankrupt the EU and the United States. And that's how they make these changes. The Ebola is just another mechanism for this same template.
So when do you, before we close off here, now the Sovietization of America, when do you expect to see it get to the stage of the gulags?
They do have the Siberian gulags have been replicated, and they're in Alaska. They have camps up there. That's where the mental people they diagnose or they determine or they label mental problems. They'll be sending them up there, and they built a railroad that goes from North America all the way up to Alaska now. To transport them. When I was in Seattle a few years ago on speaking tours, I met people who had been welding shackles into railroad cars to transport human beings in. We have FEMA camps all over the U.S. They've been built, constructed 20 years ago.
So my question would be then, like this collapsing, I suppose at some point in time it is going to get to the stage of chaos where all these draconian measures will need to be put into place, you know, where you'll have essentially martial law and people, you know, being rounded up and all that. Do you foresee something like that?
It's already started. I'm seeing it already. It started January 1st in the San Francisco Bay Area. Homeland Security moved in with Janet Napolitano, who had been head of Homeland Security, and she was suddenly hired a year ago in the summer by the University of California. They didn't do a search for any other presidential candidates to be hired. They just hired her. And the whole university and many people in California were against it. And she brought Homeland Security into the president's office of the University of California. And she's running FEMA and Homeland Security out of the president's office. And the state of California is being rolled over right now by her and Homeland Security and FEMA. And the first thing they did was to go in and survey every grocery store, every food outlet, to go into all the cafes and restaurants. They had their own people sitting at the cash register that started January 1st, doing inventories and monitoring the cash flow for a week or 2 weeks in every store. And they have trained gang stalkers. They've been training them for years, University of California. The cars have hidden antennas on them, and they travel in groups and target houses. They target pedestrians. They hit you with these very...
So then you say there's this There is an electronic gulag that has already been built.
And
at some kind of trigger event, like this outbreak or a massive earthquake or whatever, any kind of disaster or an economic collapse would then put all these preparations that have been made that are sort of still hidden. They'll all come out into the open then.
They're not hiding the gang stalking at all. It's everywhere in America. It's all over the Bay Area. Any street you go on, any store, it's an erosion of our constitutional rights across the U.S. And what is going to trigger it is food riots. They already had all of the food in the United States under their control, maybe even 10 years ago, FEMA and Homeland Security. So what they're going to do is food riots. They're already decreasing the variety of food items that were sold in the Bay Area in grocery stores. There are fewer and fewer choices now. The quality of the paper wrapping and packaging has declined. Food prices are going up $1 or $2 on everything every month. They are poisoning the meat, the chicken, the pork, and ducks. They are so foul and full of the worst chemicals you've ever tasted or smelled that I won't buy them or eat them anymore. And if I boil a chicken or a duck, there's an inch of this nasty, gray, bubbly scum on the top of the cooking pot. I can't even make chicken broth anymore. So people are buying meat from outside of the country only, who are aware of this, and lamb from New Zealand and Australia is still good. Beef and pork from Europe, European countries, is still good. They won't allow that in those countries. But we're seeing a general degradation of food items, of food quality, of wrapping and packaging, and you see more and more homeless people. They're the gang stalkers. The cops pick them up. They're in poor health. They made them stay out all winter in the radioactive rain and everything. A lot of them died. So then they bring in the next layer. The brown shirts will be next. They will kill them when they're through using them, just like Hitler did. And then the elite troops will be in charge, and the police state intensity will be much worse than it was in Russia, in the Soviet Union, during the communist period. It will be much worse. It is, I just see it coming. I've read what David Rockefeller and Brzezinski promised us. The smart meters are hooked up to the Inmarsat satellite system, which was part of the Flight 370 search and investigation. They screwed it up. And anybody with a smart meter, all their data, all their information is going straight to the Inmarsat satellites. Main satellite is geostationed over the Cameroons in Africa, but the headquarters is in London. So London can look into any person's house, any daily habit, at any moment, anywhere in the world who has a smart meter. And that is to fulfill David Rockefeller's promise that everyone will be a barcode on a satellite. And that's what Agenda 21 was for. It's a global inventory of every animal, every food item, everything. And there will no longer be currency exchange or banking. You will not be allowed to take anything out of the system any more than what you put into it. So it's a total global slave state controlled from satellites.
Well, Loren, you know, like you are sharing information which most people might find incredulous, but nonetheless, the world is, truth is stranger than fiction, that is for sure. So now we're kind of running out of time. So before we go, first of all, I want to thank you for taking the time to speak with us. But secondly, could you please share like your website and any contact information that you would like to share with the listeners?
Yes. My website is LorenMoret.info. That's the homepage. The name is spelled LeurenMoret.info. And there's a menu on the homepage. People can click on any of the links depending on what story they want to read or what video interview they want to watch. And we're putting yours up that I do with you also, because you're such an excellent, excellent host and interviewer. You have very good comments, really good insight, and I really enjoy doing interviews with you, Paul. Thank you so much for educating the public. You and I are educators. I'm not a celebrity activist. I'm a scientist and an educator, and so are you. So have a wonderful day, and I hope everyone listening will come to all of your interviews, and I'm looking forward to our next interview. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Loren. You have yourself a wonderful day as well, and let's talk again soon.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Bye.